Maybe I'm foolish, maybe I'm blind, thinking I can see through this and see what's behind. Got no way to prove it, so maybe I'm lying. But I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put your blame on me. Don't put your blame on me. Take a look in the mirror. What do you see? Do you see it clearer? Or are you deceived in what you believe? 'Cause I'm only human after all. And you're only human after all. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put your blame on me.
This is the Bahamas Department of Corrections. Built in 1952, the facility was designed to house 400 inmates. Today, it houses an overcrowded 1,800 inmates in 7 prisons on the compound. The majority, more than 1,000, are in maximum security under the originally built facility of 400. The 7 prisons include central intake, remand, female, annex, minimum, medium, and maximum. It's important to note that for most of its 66 years of existence, it was known as Her Majesty's Prison. That was later changed following the Act in Parliament that transformed the institution from punitive to correctional in 2015. For an inmate's admittance, the process begins in Records, Warrants, and Court Relations Department. It's where their new life, as it is commonly referred to, is created and established on paper.
Records, Warrants, and Court Relations is responsible for all of the inmates' records. We're also responsible for all the correspondence coming from all of the various courts, including the institutions, which is Attorney General's Office, all Magistrate and Supreme Courts, all foreign embassies. Everything that is pertaining to any inmate comes directly into Records Department. When they first come into Her Majesty's Prison, we have to go and interview that person. They're given a file. That number that we give them stays with them for life. We generate one file for you, and if you return, we usually pull that same particular file and we just write the necessary new information so that we'll be able to keep information in chronological order.
We have a prison module, which is a makeup of a number of professionals, doctors, the past chaplain, my deputy Claire. He's the chairman of that group. They sit down with the inmate, you know, and they go through a series of questionnaire, you know, and the system, you put those in the system. The system tells you whether he is high risk, low risk, medium, or what have you, and they go through and set a sentence plan. You know, if person that cannot read, give him remedial classes, and then he advanced based on the time he has in the institution. If you have an anger problem, then he's recommended for anger management and some other classes. But all in all, the law states for you to get a third of your sentence off, you must be industrious and you must be a good behavior. I can't automatically give you a third of your sentence.
Bahamas Department of Corrections is a farce, it's a fallacy. It is not what they crack it up to be at all. It's not.
What do they crack it up to be?
They're trying to make it seem as though they're heading in a different direction.
So you don't think that that's happening?
No, I've witnessed that it's not happening. I'm a part of it's not happening.
What have you witnessed that?
Okay, here it is.
You say it's not happening.
Okay. On admission, there's not a proper classification system. It's severely flawed. It is severely flawed. Hey, lived it. I came in, 5 other guys with me, just get fresh sentences the same day, and we all ended up in the same place. I, with the most serious charge, attempted murder. The least charge was vagrancy. How is this gentleman in the same cell with me? hey, I'm doing time for a violent crime. He's doing time for being somewhere he shouldn't. You see where I'm going with this?
This is the medium security prison. Inmates are identified by wearing the blue stripe uniforms. While many of their crimes can range to some of the most serious offenses, for the most part, these inmates are either preparing to be released or their behavior is considered model. This prison is perhaps the most comfortable and said to be the nicest, although even that comment you will soon see is an understatement given the outdated rundown condition of the facility. Medium security has a capacity of 300, but houses in dorm style 243 inmates. Their stories are quite telling. Some have been in prison for a long time for serious offenses. Many of them are involved in jobs on the facility.
Well, my life is more of an adventurous type of life. I used to live like just for the day, you know, not too concerned about tomorrow. I even know I made 21 years old. I was looking at even my people and all was looking for me to end up dying before I reached 21. They had me in a whole lot of insurance and things like that because of my waywardness of living. My life at that before I came here was very enjoyable. It was so good until my companion told me that she is ready to go home. She don't want to live in this condition she's in. What happened, she had a sickness. She was a manic depressive, plus she was a war veteran, and she wanted to die here in the Bahamas. She was a visitor, a foreigner. She wanted to die here in the Bahamas and asked me if I can take her life off. I agreed, and I did it. To a point, I regret and doing what I did do because of the law. But between me, her, and God, I feel like I did the right thing for her.
And a place like this, I don't think is fair for the government to have us as human beings living in this kind of condition. The food is very poor. Every morning you eat cream, every cracker, so maybe on Wednesday you get hot dog and egg, and that's that, okay? The food is very poor, okay? This old jail need to be recycled and do something better, because if you have fellas them locked down these long years like Mandela, they reform, make themselves a positive, to make a positive contribution back to society, the government even ain't looking to give them a chance. All they doing right here, right now, my brother, is breeding a lot of criminals.
Come to jail. You start to rehearse your whole life in your mind and start to get a lot of flashbacks. And this is the point where you need to pull yourself together on that first night, because if you don't, you'll find yourself hallucinating. And I went through a struggle of trying to keep a sound mind within my first night because I was exposed to an environment that I've never been before. I was placed in a section called Central Intake. The cell was very small. There was only a door, or what they would call a gate, an iron gate. There were no windows, so every time you spoke, you heard your voice echo through the cell. And there were drawings on the wall. And it felt as if every time I moved, the drawing was looking at me. So you really start to hallucinate a little bit on your first night. Basically, what I did was pray and sing. And that's how I made it through the first night. We would sing Break Every Chain for hours in tears, the whole block. Break every chain, break every chain. And every time I would stop, the guys would say, keep singing, don't stop. So my first night was very difficult. As it moved on, I came into contact with an individual called Chaplain Angelo Roll, who is a member of the chaplaincy department. And it was this gentleman that assisted me and helped me. Had I not been in contact with him, I cannot tell you what state of mind I would be in right now.
In medium security, many of the inmates work on the compound, with a significant amount of them assigned to the kitchen. The prison kitchen prepares and provides 3 meals a day to inmates. Workers are thoroughly checked and collected at the crack of dawn between 5 and 6 a.m. to begin the preparation. On the menu this day, hot dog, bread, and boiled egg. For those on a special diet, tuna. Workers also get their supplies for the day out of the central supplies. Believe it or not, most of the products here are recognized name brands, with no special ingredients added, as has been a long-time myth of the prison food. Once supplies have been distributed to the kitchen staff, the preparation begins to get breakfast ready for the inmates. The work takes place in the kitchen that has clearly been around for some time, evidence that repairs are long overdue. Nonetheless, the work gets done systematically. You will hear from many inmates the complaint that the food is far from delicious.
Eat for breakfast, we have like 26 trays of bread that's catered to the whole jail. Maximum, we'll have like 15 trays that catered to about 1,000 plus. Remand center, we'll have 6 trays of bread that catered to 310. Medium, we'll have 4 trays that catered to 254. First offenders, minimum security, they have 1 tray of bread. They have like 61 inmates in minimum. These pots are on the stove today for tea for inmates for this morning. Mostly these pots are the 80-gallon pots, and we cater them for tea or cream of wheat. The menu is egg, hot dog, bread, and tea. That's for all the inmates in the jail. We heat the pan on the stove before we go for the inmates so that the water could be hot in time, because we have to carry a pot of tea to maximum security for court before each inmate goes. So they get tea and bread before they go to court, something hot before they go. We normally have like 20-something inmates every morning that help us prep and do other stuff. So, you know, it's never enough, but that's how jail runs right now. We try and limit it a lot of salt, because we have a lot of inmates are right now on special diet, like insulin and stuff like that. So we try to limit the salt so everybody can try and maintain eating. What happens is we have a specific menu that we cater to every day. So whatever we cater to, some people on each subject. So we just have to stick to what, you know, the government provide for us.
The first I come in jail, I didn't eat. Every time I go to the table, I was like, I want only a little bit, only a little bit. I don't like the food. No.
The food that you're used to, that's a no-no. I've been sick the first 2 weeks I've gotten here, so I haven't been eating like that. And the food is yeah, it's horrible. And I've taken that for granted home. And I know one thing, I'll never take it for granted again.
The female prison houses around 70 to 74 inmates, as it fluctuates. They live in dorms with bunk beds and a cell block for challenging inmates.
Denise, let's go. Denise, come into your cell, woman. American, what are you in here for?
You ice the chief. I don't know.
You don't know?
Nobody else don't know what they in here.
How long
are you? Why I can't call my family for 60 days? Why I can't have a visit and then I can't write? I don't have no contact with my family.
Where?
Why don't you just wait till the embassy comes and these the last words I'm going to say?
Where are you from?
I plead the fifth and I want to call my lawyer.
Where are you from?
America.
What part of America?
I want to call my lawyer.
So you don't have anything to say?
Stop playing the psychological games and give me a call to my lawyer.
And they try to lie on me and say I am suicidal, which is not true.
That's why
you know, I was framed.
That's why you're in the cell?
Yes, that's why I'm in the cell and I am innocent. And then when I came here too, I also was being like mistreated by some people, not all. You have some very good people here. Not all are bad, you know? Like about, say you have 30% who are very good here, but out of 70%, no. I have two witnesses, Ashley and American, because American says she will talk to the American embassy. Her name is Pauline. about what happened here and what she saw here, the inhumane treatment of some colleagues, because all my clothes were stripped, my hand was handcuffed, and my feet were shackled.
So you're not suicidal?
No, ma'am. I never was on no medication. Of course, I'm not suicidal. I'm a working mother.
How many children?
I have three kids. I'm a working independent mother, and they can look at the quality of my children.
They have their own eating area where meals are served. Faith-based hall for learning, religion, and a medical area.
Each inmate medication is labeled, the time they're supposed to take it, the course, and how long they're supposed to take it, and the name of the medication and the expiration.
We are the four prison nurses that were trained in this area of nursing.
Is it overwhelming for you?
It's very overwhelming. You can imagine the number of medications we have to serve morning, noon, and afternoon.
The women here are serving sentences ranging from drug convictions to murder. While many are ashamed to appear on camera, others share their stories. Stories that altered their lives. This inmate ended up in an abusive relationship. She was a hotel employee who met her Prince Charming on the job, only to discover that he was reportedly abusive. She was too ashamed, she says, to speak out, and because of her reluctance to get help, it caused her freedom. She spoke with our April Sands.
Breaking point was when I was crying in the bathroom and my daughter was right there. And she was like, oh, mommy, don't cry no more. He ain't gonna beat you no more. And that was just like my breaking point when I was like, okay, I can't go through this no more, because most of the time, like when he hit me, she was right there. And I was like, I don't want my daughter to be going through this same thing and her thinking that it's okay for a man to hit us.
This inmate was in a relationship with her boyfriend for 1 year before realizing that he was obsessive. Pregnant at the time and wanting to end the relationship, she expressed to her boyfriend that she wanted an abortion.
Take the screwdriver and put it by my neck and say, I'll juke you. So then I get my cell phone and I say, you want me to call the police for you? And I was like, come off me, pushing him off me. So he picked me up while I have my baby in my hand. He body slammed me on the car. So at this time, all the landlord, her son, her sister, and some of the neighbors outside watching or what's not, so I was like, call the police. So they just stand around saying, oh, leave her alone. If she want to go, let her go.
She said she was fully unaware what she had done.
When he was pulling me and I reached in the car and my hand clapped, catch something, I just swung back. I didn't even have no idea what it was. Up to this day, I didn't even know what it was, because they said they took pictures of it.
So as he was grabbing you, pulling you from the door,
mm-hmm.
you had grabbed something in
your hand. Yeah, and I just swing back. Door. I swing back, and when I swing back, he let me go, and that's when I run.
This inmate is planning for her release date. She wants to start her own business.
Right now, my business plan, how I do it out, how I say what I want, the vision. Mm-hmm. How I can set up my business idea. See it right here. My business idea. See, shoe candy, that's what it's going to be called. Earrings, bracelets, and stuff. Yes.
But like most places in the story of survival, it's an environment that's hard. The conditions are poor, and even the nurses and officers agree it's inhumane and challenging at best.
What's hard for you guys?
Because I don't smoke. But on a daily basis, I have to be around smoke. They smoke cigarettes. I have to come in the dorm with all the coughing. I'm sick. The dorm is sick. I'm sick also.
You know, you have persons that come off the street who don't know about cleaning and stuff. And so they're mixed with persons who know how to keep themselves. And so, you know, it spreads. You know, contact dermatitis. It spreads. So it's frustrating, because here it is. You may have an inmate that comes from off the street who know about a clean lifestyle, and they come and they a house with somebody who doesn't know how to clean. And so that alone is frustrating.
They have two showers. Normally two friends or someone who's not ashamed will go in the shower at the same time.
There's a garbage bag we use for shower curtain. And the garbage is in the bathroom also.
Now, why the garbage bag?
So the curtain wouldn't get wet.
With all these things out, you could get a shower curtain, right?
Jail does not supply shower curtains.
The biggest health risk is when we have a break of rashes.
From the water?
From the water. I don't know the exact source, but water.
Are you ever concerned for yourself?
Yes. Yes. It is a health risk, you know, and we don't get risk allowance. So I think that should be put in place as well. No, we don't. And we are dealing with leaks.
Yeah.
Feces, urine, coughs, colds, everything.
This used to be our laundry. We had a fire about 10, 12 years ago. And we've been on a quest to have it repaired, refurbished, refurnished since then. But up to now, this is still where we're at.
You said 10 years ago?
Probably more than 10. I don't remember exactly when this happened, but it should be more than 10 years ago.
When the water is nothing to play with. You know, you take for granted you have that water at home, and you know, we take a lot of things for granted out on the streets. And one thing, bathing, your water, being able to use your bathroom and your own privacy, and that's been taken away. And, you know, being able to see my kids, hear from my kids when I want to. Someone, you know, you a grown woman, adult telling you, a woman telling you when to get up and what time to get up, and that's ridiculous too. So we take those things for granted, and I'll let everyone know there, know that if you don't want your freedom taken away from you, if you don't want someone telling you when and when not to do things, take heed, you know, because people speak to you out there, and sometimes we take for granted what people have to say to us, especially family members and people of authority, and we take that for granted. So I'll tell everyone out there, you know, this is no place you want to be.
You see how the dorms are set up, you know, with bunk beds and everybody together.
Yeah.
You eat together, you sleep together, do everything together. So that's why certain habits we cannot control, you know, only so much we can do, you know. Yeah.
Prisons are usually have a more punitive orientation, so you're just concerned about making sure that the inmates are locked down in a secure environment. Fine. The same applies in corrections. However, we are more concerned with rehabilitation. So we're making sure that the inmates attend educational programs, vocational training, cognitive behavioral therapy programming to address their needs. So that's the difference, getting staff to have a more rehabilitative orientation as opposed to being more 24/7 locked down. With change in legislation, overnight we went from a prison to a correctional facility. But there are some things that need to be in place to make sure that we can operate as a fully functional correctional facilities. We ought to be able to offer programs and services to address the needs of the inmates. We have to address the needs of the causes of crime, you know, the issues that made them susceptible to criminality in the first place. So we must offer more programs and services to address those needs. For instance, substance abuse. Many inmates come in, use marijuana, excessive use of alcohol. So obviously they have an issue with substance abuse. We must be able to have programs to address that. Anger management, parenting skills. We offer many of these courses, programs, but we need to offer more of them. So we need to look at social justice in the Bahamas. Yes, we need to correct them and punish them for the crimes, but we need to look at root causes. What led to this criminal behavior in the first place? That's what we need to address. Firstly, for recruits, for the most part, they undergo a 16 weeks. It's usually 16 weeks training in security techniques. They're exposed to our mission, vision, core values. They're exposed to legislative framework, the Prison Act, well, now the Correctional Services Act. We're talking about penal code, the Constitution, how government works, terms and condition of employment, the management of offenders. They're trained in emergency situation, firearms training, first aid. That's a new officer coming in. So they'll be in the Correctional Training Institute and they'll go through that training. Once they have graduated, we have an 80 hours program where they come back in for refresher courses. More seasoned officers will be exposed to training locally and internationally. We have a growing problem with security threat groups or gangs. So staff will receive training in those areas. Anything that we're not able to provide here, we source other areas where we can send the staff to receive the training. So many of our officers will be going overseas for training because we are new to this thing called corrections. And so what we are trying to do is learn from those who are considered model correctional facilities. So in Canada, in the US, who've been at it for a while, to prepare our staff to address the situations we have going on here.
Okay, presently we have vocational as well as academic programs. In the vocational area, we have cosmetology, basic electronics, we have ceramics, we have cosmetology, we have welding, we have auto skills. We also place persons in various work schemes like the plumbing area, inmate enterprise, whereby which they learn sewing and crafts. We also have carpentry, lock making, all of those. We send persons to those areas, but when they actually sit in the classroom, we deal with the less heavier industrial area. Usually we qualify persons based on their length of stay because we are preparing them to actually go in the outside world. And so we look at their sentencing anywhere between 1 to 5 years. We look at it from that perspective. They give them a sense of self-worth. They feel as if they're a part of something. And for some of them, when they leave here, you'll find that they call back if they didn't get their certificate, because they want these certificate, and they present them to go to work, and persons employ them based on what they would have gotten in here, especially our welding program.
We're assessing inmates based on our professional opinion, and what we propose to have done in the near future is to have an assessment, scientific assessment tool, to utilize to assess all of the inmates so we could be able to correctly identify what caused them to reoffend and place them in the relevant programming. And in doing so, we have identified programming in Canada, because I'm not sure if you're aware that the prison has signed an MOU with Canada to assist us with training officers in corrections. So it's proposed that we sent a group of officers off to do the ICPM program, which is Correctional Evidence-Based Programming, to train them to deliver the programming to the inmates, whereby we could reach a wider number of inmates and expose them to the CPT programs.
A big part of the work program is a production of license plates for the country. And if you didn't know, these plates emanate from the prison.
So, all of the work comes from out of the office. I come in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
I give them order.
Mm-hmm.
the order says which station is going to today, who's going to embrace it, who's going to scan it, mm-hmm. who's going to box it. They give them the order, they go ahead, they go to the machine, they pull up that order, and they begin that order.
As inmates, we endorse this project by our boss, Mr. Clare, because you have other inmates like yourself. We basically, when we enter society, we basically in life for a high enough, not a high enough, basically because we can enhance ourselves.
There's also the tailor shop where offers as an inmate's clothing are made. Auto mechanics and carpentry, a big part of training as well. And who could forget block making. And for many of these inmates, they come to prison already with a skill. Take, for example, Prince Hepburn. He was the subject of a high-profile case during the murder of his estranged girlfriend. However, for Prince, his skill as a contractor still comes in handy. He's busy helping to improve services and building new buildings at the prison.
That's something I never expected. And, you know, me as a person, I was always God-centered, you know, and spent all my life in church, really, and God-centered, but, you know, got sidetracked, got in a relationship, and so happened that, you know, the incident happened, and up until then, no one could ever think, even who see us every day, whatever, and think what I mean, something like that would never come to mind because I'm not that type. I'm, you know, God know my heart. I really not that type, but it happened. And, you know, you have regrets because, you know, someone you love, and if someone would ask, well, how could you claim you love a person? But in this life, I tell you, things happen because if anyone who know Prince Hepburn and the real Prince Hepburn from child would never be able to tell you that, you know, I would be in a place like this because I've always exemplified, you know, good personality, fun to be around, fun loving, kind, very sociable. I mean, it's not something that I'm putting on. The record is out there. You get anyone you ask, anyone on the street about Prince Hepburn, anyone in the church about Prince Hepburn. The Prince Hepburn on that incident would never be me.
So after 6 years, obviously you loved her.
Yeah, God, heaven knows it, you know, and I've exemplified everything in the world, everything, even by telling her every day. I mean, I even count the times a day, you know, and you know, God knows it. You know, I really don't. Sometimes I think about it, it still makes me cry because God knows in my heart. God knows in my heart. I still love her to this day. But I was disappointed. And
disappointed
instead of me taking a trip, I just, you know.
Disappointed in what exactly? How did it go from, I love this woman and she means the world to me, to homicide?
Because when I met her, I you know, I really asked her these questions. I'd like you to be true with me. Tell me what's going on, you know, if you see anyone, because me and my profession, I've had opportunity. You know, this me in this form, but when I was out there, I had opportunity because I was a businessman, working, doing jobs, making money all the time. I had opportunities to do a lot of stuff too, but because I chose, I'm not gonna I'm a man of my word. If I say something, I mean it. All my life, I've been like this. And that's why ain't nothing what people can do to get me to change, because I'm always a person of principles. You know, and if I ask you, you know, things before we really get together, and you're telling me one thing, and, you know, and I find another, it really threw me in a, it really, I didn't know where to turn. You know, God knows that I really don't know where to turn, you know. And
so that day you were just kind of at the end of
it. Yeah, I was, that's the worst day of my life. I wouldn't wish on my worst enemy. One day you could turn from the nicest person and the best person in the world to something that people would never think. No, not my family or even my worst enemies, whatever. Imagine me in a place like this, because I never lived my life for this. I pass this way every day, going to work, cameraman, then to work, working all about. You know, never know I'd be in a place like this, but I'm here, and the world could tell you. I had people, you know, who really had my back and wanted me to do things, and jobs and things I was supposed to be doing right now, but because this incident and threw me in prison, you know, it really hurts, but God knows the future. I don't know if he's merciful to me and come out, but if I was to see her now, and you know I love you. God knows that every day I tell this woman I love her, every day. We learn together every day. I can't believe it. I really can't believe it, Miss Brown. You know, it's, I don't even know what to say, because it's not me.
One of the good things of the Bahamas Department of Corrections is health care. A team of doctors and nurses are on staff around the clock to take care of inmates. When you arrive to the facility, a full medical is administered to give the professionals an idea of what each patient is. They work in tandem with other healthcare facilities as well off the premises. Dr. Hastings Johnson heads up medical services. He says the biggest challenge is dissemination of medication.
In the male population, we would normally have about anywhere from 300 to 500 persons on medication. So our minimum quota should be at least about, let's say about 25 orderlies, if we're gonna really be able to reach them. And so hopefully one day we will reach that goal. Basically, the orderlies are responsible for giving medication to female. Then you have maximum security. Then you have the remand center where we are right now. You have minimum are down at the gate, and you have medium. So basically, in a lot of cases, you have two orderlies trying to accomplish and dispense medication between the hours of, say, maybe 6 and 2, and then there's another shift between 2 to 10, and another one between, say, 10 p.m. and 6 a.m. Most of the medication is actually distributed in the morning. The truth is, you really only have a very, very small frame. So take, for instance, 6 o'clock in the morning, breakfast hasn't been served yet. In a lot of cases, patients are required to eat along with their medication. So the truth is, you have a window between 9 o'clock and 12 noon to get those medication inside there. So that is our challenge right there. You know, maybe what we need to do is have more people working during that small time frame, and I think we'll be able to accomplish the job a little bit easier and more effectively. In my opinion, prisoners probably get better health care than the average person on the street. Some inmates, I see them sometimes 3 times a month. The average population, they would actually wait probably months or years to get some of the care that some of the inmates get. The truth is, the hospital system is overcrowded, the clinics are overcrowded, and people do not get to see the doctors as quickly as inmates do, in my opinion. In fact, we now have a system where courts are now even mandating that inmates be seen. And so, you know, we have our work cut out for us. Fortunately, we have 3 physicians here. I honestly believe we could use a fourth one, you know, to accommodate vacations and maybe sick days, etc. But I think the inmates get better treatment because they don't have to worry about how they're going to pay for it. And basically that is what a lot of people believe universal care is. And so that's why I believe I have a great insight as to what it's going to be like when nobody has to worry about how they're going to pay for healthcare. In my opinion, hypertension, diabetes, they are almost indigenous to our culture. You know, there are a lot of persons who believe that certain things are hereditary. I don't share that view. My view is if you live in a house with certain people and you eat the same foods, you have the same habits, you will have the same diseases. And so our country, the meal plan somewhat predisposes us to certain diseases, and hypertension and diabetes is among those diseases. For the most part, we see, you know, coughs, colds, sinusitis, some bronchitis, etc. You may have some dermatitis. In my opinion, I think is caused, generally speaking, by using harsh soaps and not having moisturizers to put on your skin. So those are the kind of things that we see here. And of course, you know, we have some emergencies just like the other hospitals. And whenever we do have an emergency that we deem necessary, we then refer them to the Princess Margaret Hospital. Like it or not, the more you come into contact with bacteria, viruses, fungi, whatever, the more likely you are to develop some sort of dermatitis or some sort of infection that may be even capable of getting into your body or into your bloodstream. And so we do have some concern about that. We've always been recommending that the inmates at least be allowed to have some means of cleaning the surface of the latrines that they use. And I think that in itself would avoid a lot of stuff. But the fact is, you know, it is what it is. And yes, it does contribute to ill health to some degree. The truth is, from what I know, I think the prevalence of HIV in our country, in our population, is probably like about 2%. From research that I have seen, the prevalence in prison or among inmates is probably about 8%. The truth of the matter is, I guess this is a population of persons who may have similar lifestyles, and they are kind of congregated in this environment because of their lifestyles. And so it's not surprising to find that the incidence of HIV among inmates being higher. Because take for instance, if somebody is prone to alcoholism or drug abuse, then their inhibition would be lowered and they would be more likely to engage in unprotected sex, etc. So it's not surprising to find the incidence of, and not incidence, but at least the prevalence of HIV being a little higher in this population than it is in the regular community. The mental health of the inmates, in my opinion, is probably of great concern as well. In fact, right now as we speak, on Thursdays at about 1 or so, the psychiatrist, Dr. John Dillett, consultant psychiatrist from Mobile Sandlands, he and his team comes across and they see inmates inside the maximum security for a couple of hours, and they do that every week on a Thursday. So that helps a whole lot with it. But the fact is, like it or not, the mental health is a big issue here, because the truth is, the people that reside here are very similar to the population that resides at Sandlands. And so the fact of the matter is, mental health probably should be prioritized even more, in my opinion. I think it deserves a full-time psychiatrist in-house if we're going to really, really see some change in inmates or any form of real rehabilitation. And so, you know, if you're going to punish somebody to the point where you are going to remove them from the face of the earth, then do that. But if you're going to keep them here, I think everybody deserves to have proper, clean environment and a place to sleep where they're comfortable without having to worry about somebody taking advantage of them or having to worry about whether or not they're gonna get a good, nutritious meal. For security reasons, I don't travel the halls much, but if I were to take the stories that I hear from other inmates, I would like to see some improvement. I'd like for an inmate to be able to have clean walls and a nice sleeping pad. Your question is, would I describe it as nasty? I'd rather not answer that question, Mark.
Built for a capacity of 400, but housing more than 1,000, maximum security at the Department of Corrections is overcrowded. So much so that in a small cell, as many as 6 men can be crammed together. For the most part, proper toilet facilities don't exist. Inmates use buckets. In fact, they do everything in their cell, eat, sleep, brush their teeth, and pass their waste, all in buckets that are thrown out only twice a day. From early in the morning, before sun up, the shift changes and the count takes place to ensure no one has escaped. That done, it's now time to empty the buckets from each cell, carrying the waste from inmates overnight. The buckets are retrieved and emptied into a pit in the courtyard. The scent, indescribable. For those afforded showering privileges, the shower room and toilets are a far cry from standard. The open showers with just a pipe with a hole at the end leaves inmates frustrated.
We have about 12 people in the shower right now. Sometimes more.
The toilets, broken down and filthy. Exercise is a luxury. Once a week, inmates get an hour. For those going to court or being admitted in maximum in the morning, the reception department is an unpleasant shock.
This is the reception department where searching is done, and we all have to get from this cell right here. We have about 50 inmates at a time sometimes, and when they come inside this department, they're all loose. And so we let them out of the cell one at a time. We have officers lined off right alongside here. We use the reflective mirrors right there so inmates can squat over so they can be searched properly. Now this area, a lot of action goes down inside this department from time to time.
What kind of action?
Like, we have inmates that try to settle their scores with one another from different rivalry gangs inside this area because they know they have to be searched in this area. So they know when they come inside this department, they say, okay, I can get to my co-accused who's testifying against me, or I can get to somebody else who I dislike. So when they come inside, they say, okay, we have about seven officers to 30 inmates. Because on any given day, we have about, let's say, 35 to 60 inmates going downtown. I'm not even talking about the remand section. That's only the inmates going downtown for court. And when they come inside, we have to deal with getting their clothing ready in the morning. That's the sentencing, because they're not allowed to keep their clothing in the cells with them. Now, the remanded inmates have their own clothing in their cells, so they bring their clothing out. We can't identify those individuals because we don't know who's sentenced and who's remanded due to the fact that they swap clothes in the cells. Now, we know some of them because we try to familiarize ourselves with them. But because there's so many of them and so few of us, we can't always keep a mental note. But in terms of baggage, this area also deals with holding inmates' clothing and their other properties, money, jewelry, shoes, underwear.
Where do you store this?
We have a little storage right up here.
Up here?
Yes, we have a little storage.
That's where you store them.
And then we have another storage area. I'm going to be honest with you. That storage area is in, I don't even want my clothes in there. Because
exactly.
My clothes go inside there. It isn't coming back the way that I left it. Because those are roach infested areas.
Exactly.
So we as a union, right, in my opinion, is inhumane for me to have my clothes in there. I want my clothes to be stored in the nice place.
Exactly.
Because that isn't how I live.
Does it get physical in here?
In all honesty, it does. I'm not going to sugarcoat anything and say that it doesn't. Mm-hmm. You, when you come and you approach me and you're asking me to squat over a mirror, I feel as if, hey, you're being violated. Right, you're violating me as an individual. Why do you want me to do that? So I'm going to get aggressive with you as an officer because I'm looking at you like, I don't want to do this. Even though you're on the other side of the fence, I don't want to squat in front of another.
And they're all right there in the cell.
Well, let's go right here inside the cell so you can see what's going on the other end.
So the mirrors are to look up under their pants?
Right.
Right.
Under the backside.
Not under their pants. They be nude.
Right, completely nude.
So they're naked here?
Yes.
And everybody in the cell is right there waiting.
Yes.
And they're naked in front of everybody.
Right, yeah. So when they come out and they're searched, we then put them outside one at a time and handcuff them.
And then they put their clothes on?
Yes, they put on their clothes before they go outside.
Before they go outside.
What happened to them? Because these came into play because of the fact that inmates usually insert the contrabands into the rectum and tape it onto their legs and stuff like that. So that's why you make them squat and cough. You understand?
This is before they leave to go to court.
Right. Before and after when they come
back. When they come back as well.
Yes, sir.
So they literally have to come and stand over this,
yes,
over this mirror like this, naked, yes, and then they squat like this.
Yes.
And the officer has to look to see whether anything's up there.
Right.
That's dehumanizing.
Yeah, but then that's the way that most contraband come into the prison. So that's a part of our job as well.
So, and what about a room that has privacy so that these men aren't degraded in front of other inmates?
That's a good question. We don't have any of them.
But because of the place being overcrowded, you don't have a room available.
Right.
Wow. We used to, one time ago, we used to admit inmates in here, but we have a new area called intake, where we connected as one, all right? But mostly right now we deal with court. Court is our biggest thing right now, right? So we actually deal with all the inmates who go into court. They have to come through here. Then we process them. We actually search them, handcuff them, and we have all the documents, what needed for downtown. We have to go to the records department because we also work with records department, right? And we work hand in hand. So we get all the documents from records, whilst tactical, being here searching and processing, and make sure they're secure so they won't get no escape, nothing, right? And then we put them out there, and we call a parade. We call a parade with all the documents, and then we make sure that each person who going downtown the court have a documentation, all right? So that when they go out, so when they come back in, we'll have something to take them back on, yeah, all right? So that's deal with court part. But we also deal with deportation. We also deal with discharge, fine paid, and we also deal with family island courts. All right, so anybody who goes to any part of the islands for court, wherever it's the court, we prepare all the documentation for the inmate going to court, and we, police will come up early in the morning and to take all the documents, and we send them out to court with the documents, all right?
Maximum is no joke. While there are 4 makeshift dorms with 30 people in them, this in itself is a luxury. I got to experience firsthand the feeling of being placed in one of these dorms.
Okay.
So you can be a dorm.
This is what, maximum security as well?
Yeah. It's a working dorm.
Okay, so let's talk them right here. So, we're in the maximum security, the end dorm. This is considered the working dorm. As you can see, if you've seen the other conditions in the other dorms, this is probably a paradise compared to what we've seen already. Tell me, who are the people who are stationed in this dorm? What are the kind of people who are here?
The kind of people who are here, we get all different kinds. We get people who have like about a year, 2 years after lifetime. And these people, these persons, these inmates in here, they are working inmates. They go work in the tailor shop, they work in the cleaning gang, they work in the kitchen, they work at the in the office, they scrub, all like that.
So these are people who have obviously proven to have good behavior, people who have proven that they can be trusted a little more to be in this particular dorm.
Yes, it is.
So it's this kind of like the luxury place of maximum security.
Yes, it is.
Cordell Farrington is a name most will never forget, especially if you're from Grand Bahama. He was the man convicted of murdering the five missing boys in 2003. Mackison Colas, Junior Remy, D'Angelo McKenzie, Desmond Roll, and Jake Grant. It's a story that rocked the nation, leaving people puzzled as to who was behind these heinous crimes. He turned himself in. He has never spoken to the media, but on this day he agreed for the first time to tell his story. He was sentenced to death in 2006, but that was commuted to life in 2008, and in 2010, he was resentenced to life.
You're pretty much here for the rest of your life. Is that correct?
That's not for me to answer.
Are you looking to get out?
Sure.
What will that be based on, you getting out?
It would probably be based on time factor and progress within the prison, because the prison here offers the opportunity for you to make some headway to show that you want to rehabilitate yourself and move forward. So that's what I'm working on. I'm enrolled in classes. I'm active in doing artwork around the prison, for the prison, and I've been doing it from inception. And so some of these things are some of the things that will initiate, I guess, some kind of interest for leaders to say, okay, this guy deserves a chance.
And what do you feel caused you to go down that pathway of committing those offenses?
In exploring it, because I wanted to know also. Remember, my guess was just as good as anybody's guess. My confusion was like anybody, and I was in the same dilemma, interestingly, as everybody else was. But as I began to search and try to understand why I committed the crimes I committed, it may have evidently stemmed off from my childhood upbringing.
What kind of childhood upbringing you
had? It was abusive, it was sexually abusive, emotionally and physically. I was unstable in my geographical movements because I was moving from here to there and everywhere, and this one hands, that one hands, and all of these different things. It's a conglomerate of things that contributed toward me making bad choices.
And that was your childhood?
Yes, that was my childhood.
And did that carry on throughout your life as a teenager? Were you still in a whirlwind, so to speak, that's trying to find who you were?
Yeah, sure. I even on the road, I seek some guidance and help and counsel from professional persons.
And what happened?
It just didn't last, or it wasn't taken to be as serious as I guess it turned out. Obviously, it was to be taken serious. But for some reason, it faltered. There was no real progress.
You feel the system failed you?
I'm not one to be a blame, like blaming other persons or even the system, because I made bad choices initially and ultimately. But somewhere along the line, somebody failed. And I was a part of that failure.
When did you realize you had a serious problem?
When I turned myself into the police.
You turned yourself into the police?
I turned myself into the police, yes, sir.
Why did you turn yourself in?
Because I thought that was the right thing to do, and I saw I was on a trend, and I knew what I did was wrong.
It began with one, the first boy.
Yes.
What caused you to take in?
Probably, like, it's a conglomerate of things, because we always exploring these same things. And one of the things that I've come to understand and learn is that the root cause must have been out of anger. My own personal
life. Why were you angry?
Yeah, because of how I was brought up. And because a lot of things in my own personal life wasn't resolved. And maybe I was disgruntled in a lot of ways, and I couldn't express myself. I couldn't get it out. I couldn't get the attention.
You took these little boys, you saw yourself, you kept remembering yourself as a little boy going through difficult times.
That could be a metaphorical outlook on it, yes. Because certainly my objective was never to hurt anybody, period. So when I look at my victims now, and I was able to assess it properly, evidently any reasonable thinking person could say, you know something, maybe this guy might have been seeing himself.
Right.
You understand?
After your first victim, what caused you to go after another boy?
Maybe appetite and the fact that I got away with it. Those are factors.
You repeated that 5 times. And every time, what was your motivation to do the next one?
The same motivation to do the first one. It wasn't, the motivations never changed.
What caused you to stop after the fifth boy?
It wasn't so much the fifth. The idea was that it came to a point, my own cognitive thinking, where I decided that, you know something, Cornell, this is not you, this is not right, turn yourself in.
So, you recognize the city and the country was in an uproar, trying to figure out what was going on. While people were trying to figure out what was happening, what were you doing? While this made headlines everywhere, these boys were going missing, no one could find them. What were you doing when this became headlines everywhere? What was going through your mind?
You have to remember that I was also a part of society, and I was in this. I saw all of this. I have 2 sisters who are on the police force, so I knew what the police had on the person who they was looking for, and I knew they wasn't near having any clue as to who it was or where to look. I knew that they was looking in the wrong places. I was right there. I was working. I was functioning, what you would say normally. I was working a full-time job, taking care of myself, my family. I have a daughter also out there who I was taking care of. So I was in society just among everybody else while all of this was.
And you saw the grief of these families. Did it affect you?
Of course it did. Yes, of course it did.
You knew all along where the remains of these boys were.
Yes.
And you just watched and see whether they would get close.
Yeah, it's like at the time we were reverting back to the past now. At the time, I guess the criminal mind is that, okay, you don't want to be caught.
Correct.
And I would fit into that category. I didn't want to be caught. So certainly I would want to know anything of information or value would interest me to know where the authorities are in apprehending this individual. So I would try and reburn that.
When you would take the boys each time, did you lure them? Were they afraid? Did you kidnap them? Did they know you?
No, I was. None of them were known to me, and I didn't know any of them.
So how were you able to get them alone?
Just like I'm speaking to you, you just meet a person and say, hey, what's going on? And we start talking about Coke soda, then it leads on to ice cream. And it's just normal setting. There's nothing suspicious about it. This guy seemed to be okay on the side of me. You don't seem to be a person who want to hurt me or who's out to get me. So it's just a normal social setting.
These are all normal social settings. You were with them for a period of time before you killed them?
Sure.
So they trusted you?
Yeah, well, sure, I guess so.
At the point when they recognized that they were in danger, what were their reaction to you?
I suppose they were afraid.
How did that affect you?
Well, at the time I had to do what I had to do. It was like no turning back. You get to a point where there's no turning back.
It was just something that came on. How did you kill each of them?
Swiftly. It wasn't no torture or nothing like that.
Okay.
I made it clear that I never tortured anyone, but nonetheless, it was
not being satisfied with his answer, I went back to Cordell Farrington on the second day. This was his response.
They met the demise.
He's speaking about it as far as how did he die?
Yeah.
They were stabbed.
Okay. Yeah. Each of them?
Yeah, each of them.
Okay. Yeah. Were they aware of what was going on when it happened?
Yeah. They were aware.
What was their reaction when it happened?
Well, it wasn't a long like process, like hang up or anything. It's just like you're gonna die, and that's it.
You told them that?
Yes.
And what was their response when you told them
that? Nonchalant, I guess.
Nonchalant.
Yeah.
No one showed any overly over emotion.
One person, I think Remy did. Yeah.
Did they try to resist you and fight?
No, it wasn't nothing like that.
They just stabbed them.
Remember now, we spoke for a while, and I think they was comfortable and everything. So,
but they didn't have an idea what was going to happen.
Exactly right. I don't think they understood the ramifications of what I said. Yeah.
Do you still think about these five boys?
Sometimes it might sound strange, but I've been here 14 years now.
Yes.
You understand what I'm saying? And I've done a lot of things while here at the prison. And sometimes, like, I know one morning I got up and I even forgot what I was charged for. You understand what I'm saying? So it could be that thrust back in the past where you just put the past completely behind you.
Is that what you...
And that's what I did.
At one point in time, I'm not sure if it was evidence or it was just rumors, saying that portions of them you would have eaten. Is that correct?
There are a lot of stories and myths about this whole thing, and I always say, why don't you come to and hear it from the horse's mouth?
Tell us.
I've never eaten human flesh in my entire life. Let me just make that clear to everybody. I have never thought about eating human flesh. Cannibalism.
So that's not true?
Evidently.
You sit here today, years later. Any regrets?
Yeah, sure. Gotta be regrets.
What do you say to the families? This is your camera right here. What do you say to those families? It's seeing you and hearing you talk for the first time.
I don't know, I remember the last appearance in court, in Supreme Court, before John Isaacs, when we were dealing with the four boys in particular. I don't know if all of the family members were there, but if they would remember, I turned around to them and I told them that I was sorry.
And you mean that?
Yes, of course.
Do you believe you're changed, you're rehabilitated?
I don't know if that's for me to answer. I don't know if I'm the right person. I don't want to sound...
Cliche.
No, I don't want to sound caught up in myself, more or less. But I don't know if that is for me to say.
If you were to be released, are you confident that you would not have that appetite again to commit the same crime?
Oh, sure, yeah. In fact, I decided that the moment I turned myself in, that I was going to stop. So it's not like I've become a zombie where I'm being controlled by some other outside element and I can't control myself or my hands or my feet. There were choices I made. I decided not to do it again when I turned myself in.
What do you say to the people who cry in the home?
In briefest summary, first of all, I'd like to say that I knew that what I did was wrong. And I'm so sorry for what I did. And I ask that you will find in your hearts to forgive me and to allow me to move on and to rehabilitate myself and to be whole again.
For those inmates who chose a life of religion behind bars, their redemption and atonement comes through church services. The prison ministry is a source of strength for many, an expression of music, worship, and teaching.
I believe in tough love, and I've always indicated that if you treat people with respect and love, they in the end will respond. I made a 360 turnaround in my life, so when I came here, when I returned, I had that to lean on as chaplain, from officer to the chaplain.
Choices I made was wrong choices, so that's what incarcerated me. That's what, so I can't blame nobody but myself. You understand? I accept my responsibilities. So this will cost me, and it cost me 18 years, armed robbery, three counts. Three counts of armed robbery, left my little girl on the road. But then when I really sit back and think of it, right, I was being selfish, I was being foolish. I was 28 when I came to jail, now I'm 33. So I've been here for a little while, and the situations what I've seen here in this correctional facility, Chaplain Clark and Chaplain Rowe, for positive moments, they are rehabilitating youngsters' mind. You have to want to be rehabilitated. If you don't want to be rehabilitated, then you're going to go back on the road in the same way you came. But if you want to make a change in life, you have to grasp the opportunity when the opportunity represents up. See, I was ever an opportunist, so I grasped the opportunity to change. Choices are what we make in life. If I was able to turn the hands of time again, I wouldn't make that choice to jump in the car. I wouldn't make that choice to drive the car. I wouldn't make that choice to even possess the firearm if I had a chance again in life. No, I wouldn't do that.
But there are those who choose even behind bars to create disruption. These are the experts in extrication, and keeping things in order.
Like the vest, this will be the layout. Like Sarge explained, in the event that we have to do a cell extraction. All right. Shield. Front, the man in front of the foreman team. Okay. The shield off is up. The shield is basically the pin. Okay. You want to always be able to one finger. That's not have it so tight. This is how we measure the distance between.
Okay.
This is one of the ways that we would secure an inmate. Okay.
We are trained in riot control and other things in case of emergencies and riots. Now this year, we don't let everyone know our secrets. We just, for the day, we just let one or two things out of our...
Sounds good.
This year, I know you all watch a lot of TV. But this year, some CS gas, some rubber cords. So if we have any problem, you pull the pin, show it in. You know what I mean? This is, less lethal.
Yeah.
All right.
Now what is that? It blasts, cause people black out?
Yeah, disorients them.
Okay.
This is another type of gas we use as well. All right. It's a powder gas. Pepper spray. Now we have some other weapons that are less lethal. Mm-hmm. We have 40 meter launcher. Rubber bullets. Mm-hmm. And of course, we have some lethal stuff, but like I said, we can't bring everything out.
Right.
Because everything up to be a surprise.
But
we've been all across the world training in case if something was to happen. Keep everyone safe.
The Department of Corrections also has an experienced search team. Their mission and mandate to ensure no illegal contraband are on the premises.
My name is Principal Correction Officer Delvin Taylor. I have been a member of the Bombers Department of Corrections now for going on 29 years. Presently, I am in the office in charge of the Security Detection Unit. My team, we have eight members total. One of our members out on maternity leave. Well, basically, my team, we search the whole compound. We're responsible for searching the whole compound. Wherever there's need to be, we will be. If persons call in and say that some persons are calling them and threatening them on cell phones and whatnot, because the large amount of cell phones have been found so far, you know, we tend to go directly to them and search.
Put your back on the wall. You take your back off the wall with this spray. That's very good. You don't get more one after
that. On occasions, we find moonshine. We find marijuana or suspected marijuana. We can't actually say it's marijuana until it's analyzed by the police, but it's basically marijuana. On a daily basis, we report for duty like 7:45. And we have a briefing. If information come to us that we need to go and search a certain area, we in turn will go and search. But we start off basically in the office. Like I said, we have our briefing and we go from there. If there's nothing pressing, then we just continue with our reports, generating our reports for the commissioner and the deputy commissioners.
What are you guys doing now?
just a bag and everything tied in it, so when we get back to the office, just write our reports and everything will be in order.
I was present when Sergeant Dion Bowles was killed. At least I was coming to work that morning. And, you know, it was rough, but I was there. Once you go to the fellas, I mean, you don't show them no disrespect. I mean, they are humans, so you have to treat them with respect. And we go to them, show them respect, and we tell them that, you know, we come to conduct a search. We be professional, and we don't try to disrupt their day, so to speak.
So you have no qualms about walking in and taking my cell phone that I just got yesterday?
I would not have no qualms. I mean, you might, but if the phone is there,
yeah,
and we found out that it's there, we're coming for it.
Yeah. You find the phone. You find the phone. You are not a pro. No one will answer it. You are not a channel. Get the phone.
Well, we found makeshift shanks. They would make them out of the toothbrush or any piece of metal, even wood, or the bones from the turkey or large chickens. And on occasion, while I was stationed at the gate, I found some bullets, you know. And we found some other bullets inside maximum security at one point in time.
Being a part of the team, I think it's a great experience, you know, being surrounded by the men. You know, you feel secure because they're the guys that, you know, hold security. They make sure that females are always safe. I don't bring that fear because I know who I'm surrounded by, and I know the level and the extent that they would go to protect their fellow female officers. When it comes to male inmates, I always refer them to the male officers. So when I go to female, then that will be me. So the mind games wouldn't come to me, always go to the male officers.
Before we go in, usually our block of prayer to the good Lord and pray that we have a safe journey whilst we going in and that we all come out safe.
We have a lot of persons who come on the compound to do work, and in some instance they would just miss their tools, and they would not say that the tool is missing or whatever. Not given the fact that we have inmates who work inside the industries also. You know, some of them would take also remove tools from their work area. I am not in a position to admit it or deny it, but common sense would tell us that this is probably the best place to start an investigation for here.
They would ask you, you know, like, who sent you? Why are you here? And meantime, while they're trying to hide their phones or the marijuana or whatever, you know, but they're going to ask you questions. You know, you just, like I said, you just be professional with them. And to be honest, the fear is basically for my officers and my family, you know, because when you look at it, you're dealing with fellas who come to jail for a reason, and most of them are serious crimes. And when they get out, or even before they get out, you know, if they want to, they can put a hit out on you.
Hey,
So gang culture itself, it's a big issue here, and it starts from the streets, it grows in here, and then it spills back on the streets. Gang culture is a huge problem here at the Bahamas Department of Corrections.
You tell the young youths, don't come to this place. Try to stop crime, stop doing bad things, and give your life to the Lord and try to look for a better life. Because this place is no place to be. This ain't for nobody. This is not a good place. It's hard.
He was thinking about the wrong things and the bad stuff I was doing. All that. Just thinking about getting this money, and that's it. But now, you know, when I go home, change and stay far from them stuff.
Jail is not a joke. It's very hard. It's nothing to play with. Guys is coming in and lose their mind in the back. We are strong to survive in here.
I watched innocent niggas come to this jail, bosses, label them as gang members.
I'm sorry for the criminal activity I was in. I'm not in jail, but like when they come out. You know? In jail ain't no place for the one people. I tell this to all the young girls to get your education and obey your parents and don't come to prison. Very easy.
Then, certain things what they send us to jail for, it ain't make no sense. They gotta leave us on the road, let us give us probation or something, because our life being on the drain, all they doing is creating monsters. It's the system. We're turning people into beasts and into monsters.
We have plenty of inmates who really trying to educate themselves and really trying to be in a positive vibe. We get plenty who want to know gang. You see what they saying? But even if they're being in the cell run, Satan mind them, they get classed and labeled as gang members.
And now when I first come here, everyone could have just gone any blocks. In them days, you know what I mean? It wasn't no, it was gang, but it wasn't as dangerous as it is now. It was gang fighting with a little knife or a rock or ball. Now, people killing you for real. They ain't playing with you. That's how the time is now.
So you don't know, but one day you could come with you and at any time you could get guys to jump you.
Everything starts from the gang situation. If I on Satan block, right, and I go to Satan blocks, different not only me, I talk with fellas, so they'll be like, well, you get them from you, this and that, this and that, this and that. I wouldn't say it because I know it's you, you know? This and that, you know? That's how it's be. You can't go anywhere in jail. Some people got to be in security blocks.
That's wrong. You don't have 5 or 6 man in a cell. The cell was only made for 1 or 2 man. That's why plenty inmates and fight, junk up one another, all kind of stress and heart in the summer. They're killing up one another in these cells.
Some people got to be in security blocks and things because of who they with. And the gangs they affiliate with, so you gotta go with where gang is, Maras, One Order, Fire Theft. You gotta go with ASB, because you're all in gang. Then you get people who are neutral.
You see me? I'm 27 years of age, and I'm in here now for my first crime, and I tell the vowing nods to be the last time. I get a young family out there that I left on the road, and who depending on me, waiting for me to come out, and they love me, and I still in here doing foolishness.
If you come to jail and you don't want no gang, they bet you on a block. Well, you better ride it.
So officers know if you're neutral or not. Alright, you don't know gang, you go this way. Alright, you affiliate with this gang, you go to your. But when you reach in jail, it'll be like, what gang you in? I in so-and-so gang. That's what it's asked people, not me now. That's what it's asked people. So they'll point them out, alright, you go upstairs or you go this way because you're in a gang.
Segregation and separation is the only way to try to solve that problem. But that in itself presents its challenges. Because when you separate, you put everybody one place, but you strengthen in one particular gang. But that's the way we're going to have to deal with it at times. Well, conditions here have been this way from before I joined the job and probably will be this way after I leave the job. I just pray that in this lifetime we are blessed with a new correctional facility to work in, because working here has its challenges on both ends, you know, for inmates and officers, because of the conditions.
Shit buckets, fish jugs, bad food.
Every inmate has a bucket in the cell. He has to do everything in this bucket. We washing his bucket, we bathing his bucket.
Wash our teeth.
Just this morning, I was brushing the teeth right off guard. I was brushing my teeth. If I have to wash today, I can't bathe.
No.
So I have to wait until I get water the next day.
You can bathe.
So you only
but
get one bucket of water.
This is it.
Everything.
And this is the amount of water in the bucket. I have to wash, I have to wipe off, and this, I have to rinse off in this water every day. And then I have to turn around and brush my teeth over this bucket
and so forth, rinse my bowl. There is not a garbage container in the front of the cell. So where would I put the garbage? Here's the card box. We have to sleep on card box on this ground every morning. This we have to lay on. That's what he said.
It's torture. It's torture. 6 miles living in a cell. Right now. Shit. You're getting it with feasting inside a bucket.
Right now.
I locked down like 23 and a half hours a day in here. We eat food every 8 to 9 hours a day. Breakfast coming 12 o'clock at night. We exercise in like 5 minutes a day in the yard.
There's three of us in the cell, three guys in the cell. You all his friends, so we stick together with each other.
The conditions of the floor good in the back here, man. Sleep on the floor, in the slop buckets, piss jugs, smell shit all day. It's bad, it's really deplorable. The guy's skin breaking out, about dirty in the back here. It's really bad. It's not livable, I barely make it every day. I struggle to make it, it's very hard.
Inmates complain about them, how they are housed. It is what it is. Of all the facilities we have inside here, really, it is only overcrowding we have is really maximum security. Yeah, but overcrowding, but really, overcrowding is isolated to maximum security. All of the ills and negative comes out of the institution, all point the finger at maximum security. All the other institution, are not overcrowded. No, they outfitted with the basic beds, toilets, whatever, mass security. When it was built, but none of those, and it's difficult. I know when you have your walkabout, you see where we have started and tried to convince the government, the former government, to put toilets and beds inside them.
For those not fortunate to live in the dorm, they share a cell that's similar to a hole in the wall. A dark, gloomy, old-fashioned concrete cell with rusted mildew iron doors. Lighting is poor. You sleep on the floor in pieces of cardboards. You share a cell packed with up to five others, and buckets are the order of the day. Because of overcrowding, people on remand also end up staying in maximum security. While there are many there for violent crimes like murder, rape, and armed robbery, there are also high-profile drug offenders who also make up the complement. Austin Knowles, now extradited, cries out for justice and better conditions while there.
So, you're looking at almost 3 years I've been in this area.
And you were out on bail?
I was on bail for 12 and a half years.
And then what happened?
And I went to the appeals court, and the appeals court took my bail. Now, when I came out on bail in 2004, I was given bail by a Supreme Court. The appeals court took my bail. You did the story. The appeals court took my bail an hour later when I got bail from the Supreme Court. I then came out and I went to the Privy Council. The Privy Council reinstated my bail. I was on bail for 12 and a half years. After the 12 and a half years, I went back to the appeals court, and the appeals court took my bail again. So now we are waiting our decision on the Privy Council, which could take another 2 years. So we could spend another 2 years in here waiting on a ruling from the Privy Council. But my point is, if we was on bail for 12 and a half years, what is the reason for them taking our bail? We can't be a flight risk, because we was on the road for 12 and a half years. My thing is, I want to know where is the sovereignty for us as Bahamians? Because we're dealing with a situation in this country right now with one guy came named Ronnie Jones or James Charles or whatever he named. He been exported back from Haiti, back into the country, and he's walking around free. And we don't know if he's Bahamian, Haitian, or whatever nationality he is. But they focus on that. We are Bahamians, taxpayers, who pay our taxes. We have families and kids. And they put us back in jail to wait for a decision from the Privy Council, which will probably take another two and a half years. I think it's so unfair.
What is the conditions like living here?
Well, the only ventilation we get is from the Fed. So we have no ventilation. None whatsoever.
Is this, in your opinion, humane?
Very, very inhumane. Very inhumane. But the officers, they do a good job on
trying to assist us as much as they could, but they're working on the bad poor edition. So we can't blame the officers. They try as much as they could to help us. But also, there's 168 hours in a week. We only get to spend 4 hours out of the whole week outside. We go out for hour on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday.
1 hour.
1 hour. So out of 168 hours during the week, we only get to spend 4 hours outside.
And the rest is just spent in here all day,
all night. The rest we be in the cell all day, all night.
How much of you are in the cell? Two?
Three. Two of us now, and I think the other guy is coming to him now. Three of us in the cell now. Yes.
All right. What do you want people to know?
Well, we want them to know about the inhumane conditions that we living in here. Also, we want to know why the Bahamas government or the courts put us back in jail after we've been on bail for 12 and a half years.
Kofi Goodman now serves a lifetime sentence for murdering 11-year-old Marco Archer. He reportedly kidnapped him. He, to this day, denies the crime.
You were charged with murder of Marco Archer.
That's up.
That was a very high-profile case.
That's up.
In the media. When you think about that, what comes to mind when you think about that case?
To be honest with you, he said it's in my mind. You kill the old human, throw the human on the next side of the property, then that hurried up. If you look at it, the first shot, the officer saying this property, it's our property. It's probably the body you find. It's not our own. You understand me? The program present say kidnapping and sexual assault. They only charge for murder. So they didn't mislead the public right now. You see these in? All the money that gotta be amended. A fair come because lies. Are we in here wait for my chair and my grand judge? You see these in? All the iron they all feel come for, but they be honest with you on a straight up run. Die, feel what they do to my life, man.
So you maintain that you're innocent?
Are you maintaining it? God knows I'm innocent.
How do you feel knowing that you're in this place and you, in your mind, have not done this crime?
To be honest, right? I mean, I renew my mind to be a better person while I see you. You can't let the negative take the best apart and make positive within me. That's how I feel. So, amen, through the grace of God, only God has taken me and give me a positive mind, and I will more like a ability to stay stable, the same mind. What? I know, I innocent, long as I know, and others who with me, there's more who with me than against me, they show that. All right, so all this make me feel, give me more comfort, ability to have a stable ability in mind.
Kofi, if you didn't kill Marco Archer, who did?
Gotta ask the police. The police should know. Because why they covering up? Why the prosecution should know? Why they covering up? You understand me? Watch this. They say a sheep what went missing. Ain't none of the sheep what say similar to my sheep what is on my bed. They never produce none of these sheets. None of these. Why? That's the questions they got. Find answers to.
How were you brought into to stand trial for this? Why you?
Gotta ask the police, sir. Honestly, I know they look and say that my past history and say, oh, remember, I get charged 2 months after I was in prison.
Correct.
All right, waiting on a DNA report. The DNA report state that look up. Yes, my DNA was found on this. That's my resident. But more than my DNA was found on the shirt, you know. All right? It was 3 other profiles to find the shirt. That's it. Why they have charged 3 other poisons?
How was your DNA on his clothes, on his person?
It was come came from the garbage. The DNA explained, say yes, it could be drawn for.
Did you even know Marco Archer?
I don't know Marco Archer. I never seen Marco Archer. You know, but kill Marco Archer or no one in the yard, it would mean no one.
Do you feel for his family, nonetheless?
Yeah, man, I didn't tell them. I feel his sympathy. But if you all want to say you're guilty, I know you're innocent.
this is called Marco's Law. Some of the other laws of sexual offenses against children, against missing children. What do you want people to know about Kofi Goodman?
Be honest with you, let the people know it. They ain't kill no Marco Archer. They gotta find Marco Archer girl.
You were in prison before this case came up. What were you serving a prison sentence for?
Attempted murder, sir.
Attempted murder.
That's all.
You came out, you were out for how long?
10 months.
After having been here for how long?
13 years and 8 months.
So you spent 13 years and 8 months for attempted murder.
That's all.
You were out for 10 months.
That's all.
And then this.
That's all.
How did that make you feel?
Again, be honest with you. As a natural human being, on any human being with a natural ability to think, it give a Christian Monica. Monica, amen, it's undescribable. You see what he's saying? It's true, I get my child, I get my children. Now my child, get a grandchild, make a get a child. But they don't want to be there with my children and my family. See, so man, that made me feel it in a way Monica. I didn't fear that. Honestly.
Do you believe you were set up?
Pardon?
Do you believe you were set up?
Yeah, I'm automatic.
Has this made you bitter now in prison? Do you believe you're bitter?
Hey, this made me a better man. Honestly. I can't hold a grudge against what certain people think is the truth. Can reveal one way or the next. Mark me what?
Do you have any regrets about what life has presented you?
The extent. And then another extent, I thank God for the MEC. On numerous different insight. But it is not. That's what you really mean. That kind of knowledge. And I said,
if there's one thing you could have said to the public about having to be in this place, what do you want them to know?
The public are wrong for self with this place. Alright? The outside may be being beautiful, but inside, it's a whole nightmare. Amen? If they serious enough, right? Always remember this. The smallest person could be in prison, but the condition may here can make him a beast within them. Alright? Yeah. It's a system we're making people to be soon. Always remember this time. My mind is not a beast, you know, or a monster, you know. It's time. If you treating us inhumane, what you want to run through people, man? Huh? All the seeing a dead in jail, you know, some who come out worse than when they come in. Alright? The system is the beast.
Explain to me the whole process here in the gap.
The inmate usually come from Tree Hill, from the west. A bed was here. We stage here until it's time for the execution.
Were people being here?
Just an officer would be in here. Two officers would be in here with him.
What about the chaplain or something?
The chaplain will come to talk with him.
And then from this area, what happened?
From this area, after they move him from here, they'll bring him here to the gallows. Where he'll be placed on
How would they get him in here?
Yeah. The inmate usually, he come and they place him on they'll have a stool or a thing here and they'll put him up there and they'll strap him down.
So
and
how does it work?
He'll be cuffed, he'll be in jeans.
In jeans?
Yes, sir. He'll be in a jeans.
And they'll handcuff him?
Yeah, they'll handcuff him. He'll be cuffed, strapped down.
The rope will be there or something?
The rope will be there. See, that's the, this for the trap door, for when the door drop.
Pull it back up.
To pull it back up.
Okay. So you would be able to put a rope around his neck?
Yes, sir.
And they would attach it to that?
They would attach it to the,
chain. And then this door would open?
This, yeah, this would drop. This will be able to leave.
This is where the hangman would stand, or the person who really pulls the lever on the execution. He would then pull this lever here back. When he pulls this back, the door is open and the prisoner and the inmate is hung.
So quite soon your school will do the hanging, will be right here.
And somebody gives him the command.
Yes.
And so these ropes here actually would pull, helps to pull the doors back up once they've been opened and the person has been hung. This really is the end of the road for any inmate here on death row. As you know though, no one is on death row here at the correctional facility. And so all of the persons here are either awaiting a decision on what their sentence has been reduced to, or they've been given life in prison.
For many officers, working in maximum security feels like a sentence more than national service. You see, they must endure the same conditions many times as inmates. For officers, it's also a risk. Back in 2006, during a prison break by four inmates, Officer Corporal Bowles was murdered. One of the escaped inmates was captured. Barry McCoy.
Anything you want to get again, they don't open about that when they first came here.
Cigarettes.
Yeah, anything, marijuana.
Drugs,
anything. Woman, anything you want.
Did you get women in prison as well?
Yeah, anything. Once you had the money, you could get these things.
So how would that happen if you wanted a woman? What would you do?
Well, then you would pay same individuals and you would see that you could get a woman.
So they would take you to take a rope off of that and have a woman there.
Yes, sir.
You have sex.
Yes, sir.
And you leave.
Yes, sir.
And officers would arrange that.
Yes, sir, those who was in authority back then.
How many times have you tried to escape from prison?
4 or 5 times.
And obviously, were you ever successful in getting out?
Yes, sir.
But you got caught?
Yes, sir.
You would actually sit down and plan your escape? Or it was just something that just happened?
Yes, sir. Every time I plan those escapes.
Were you always locked up, or were you out on work programs when you escaped?
But I always is inside a cell or one dime on the door.
And how would you get out?
One time I cut the bars, and another time I go through the wall.
No fear.
You also see my story is this, right, sir? I came in jail in 1986, right, for armed robbery and firearm. And then I escaped in 1991, right? And I ended up getting charged. Me and David Dawkins got shot and killed by the police. And they charged me them for a sexual case. And I got very guilty and I received a life sentence, which that was my first offense on that for that matter. As the law stated, I only supposed to receive 7 years, right? And that lifetime I received, I started to play really serious on my psyche, because I know the sentence what I received is the wrong sentence. I'm supposed to receive 7 years, but that's my first offense, right? And all that contribute to me escaping or wanting to escape.
You're here for how many years?
I'm going to tell you 1 year.
How much years do you have remaining?
I have a life sentence.
Life sentence.
Yeah, the same cell matter I just explained you.
So as far as the stand right now, you're supposed to be in jail for the rest of your life?
Yes, sir.
How does that make you feel?
See, if I know the sentence is the right sentence, right, then I can accept that. But it's hard to accept that I have to be in jail the rest of my life, right, when I know that the sentence is unlawful.
Are you fighting it or trying to fight it?
My problem is, this is not another problem I have. As you know, right? Because you're using important, as you know, I was charged for an incident that happened here. Right? So now every financially I have nothing financially because my mother and my father died and we have a sister. So you see even a lawyer like that financially I really can't do it. So you, the only way you can do this is by communication, by medicine, sending documents to the prison. Every document that I sent, they don't reach the destiny. They just destroy them.
Those that lead the institution want change and want better. The step to move from punitive to correctional was indeed a step in the right direction. But we know in order to make the kind of leap that brings real change requires real money.
We have about 90 persons attached to this unit, but they're divided into four different units, divisions. Roughly 23 persons on each division, and we have four divisions.
Is that nearly enough to man this amount of inmates?
Nowhere near enough. Nowhere near enough. One of the challenges is that we are manual. We operate everything manually. If we were automated, it would have been much more easier. But the fact that everything that we do has to be done by hand poses a challenge. You would have seen during your tour in the different groups. And you got the count and the counts and the ratio of officers per block, per inmate. And you can determine from what you saw that there's no way it's near enough.
How do you do it? I mean, every day you keep your incidences down and you manage to keep a safe prison. How do you do it?
Well, it becomes almost natural. After you do something for so long, mm-hmm. you get the art of it and you manage to keep it outside of that, the grace of God. But we keep security is our watch word. Everything that we do, every move that we make, it is focused on security. Simply because if you slip, it can be you and the organization.
Right.
Officers have to be, well, both sides are vigilant, very attentive, and pay attention to detail.
On a day-to-day basis, these officers can come very familiar because they seem to be seeing people every day, and they're hearing their cries and interaction. How do they keep that separation to ensure that they don't let their guards down?
Well, you'll find that most times, a number of inmates and officers, they grew up in the same block, on the block in the street. That sometimes poses a challenge for officers to separate their professional duties from their casual relationship. But they are always, well, they are taught that a clear demarcation between the officer and the inmate. The individual that you knew on the block as my boy, he's no longer my boy. He's an inmate. And you have a job to perform, and there should be no mixing, clear demarcation.
Do you find this institution supposed to be transferring to a rehabilitative one, a correctional facility that has opportunities for offering second chances? Clearly, when you see those environments that they live in, how can you rehabilitate in that environment?
It is difficult. It is challenging. The prison built 1952. The population at that time was less than a quarter what we have today. The population in prison and the maximum security in prison in general has exploded. And we haven't expanded the housing unit to accommodate the explosion of the incidences of crime on the street. And so we find ourselves challenge with space. But what we do from day to day, we try to move those persons who are charged with less offenses and put them into the other areas that can accommodate whenever inmates are discharged. We try to put those set out of, move them out of here into those areas. And you'll find that the persons who are involved for the most part in the rehabilitative programs, they are in the medium security. where the conditions are slightly different, or similar to the dorm that you were housed in a few minutes ago.
Yes.
So it's more accommodating in those dorms for rehabilitative programs. But in here, it's unlikely that you'll be effective in here.
For governments, it's not popular to pump millions of dollars into an institute where the people can't vote for you. But many are hoping that thinking will change and a new day will truly be on the horizon for the Bahamas Department of Corrections.
Maybe I'm foolish, maybe I'm blind, thinking I can see through this and see what's behind. Got no way to prove it, so maybe I'm lying. But I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put your blame on me. Don't put your blame on me. Take a look in the mirror, what do you see? Do you see it clearer, or are you deceived in what you believe? I'm only human after all. I'm just a man, I do what I can. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put your blame on me.